Naši priatelia z Norska, z Islandu, tu boli dneska celý deň v takej pozícii, že museli počúvať celý ten balík problémov, s ktorými my na Slovensku sa tu snažíme vysporiadať. A hovorili sme o tých problémoch skutočne na rôznych úrovniach. A na jednu úroveň sme tak trochu pozabudli, a to je úroveň samospráv. A ja mám taký pocit, že keď o týchto veciach diskutujeme, sa nám to na Slovensku stáva veľmi často. Že nehovoríme o tom, aká je zodpovednosť samospráv, aká je úloha samospráv. Aj vo vzdelávaní k ľudským právam, aj v nastavovaní politík. Pri tých samosprávach nám to vyskakuje v niektorých oblastiach úplne kľúčovo. Ja som sa dlhodobo venoval, aj sa venujem téme ochrany práv detí. A tam tá samospráva je naozaj jedným z kľúčových úrovní, na ktorej by sme sa o týchto témach mali baviť. Ale nie len. To, prečo na Slovensku so samosprávami až tak veľmi často nerobíme, možno aj zo strany mimovládneho sektoru, má viaceré dôvody. Niekedy je to veľký odpor samospráv k akýmkoľvek zmenám a novým myšlienkam, s ktorými neziskové organizácie prichádzajú. Ale má to aj jeden taký veľmi racionálny dôvod, a neviem, ako je to na Islande, ale keď si urobím porovnanie s Norskom, kde je, myslím, okolo 300 samospráv v celom Norsku, kde je 5,5 milióna obyvateľov, tak na Slovensku, kde je 5 miliónov obyvateľov, máme takmer 3000 samospráv. To je zásadný rozdiel a to je zásadný problém, ktorý máme. Ja pozvem sem k nám Sofiu Vangsdóttir z Islandu, zo samosprávy Akureyri, ktorá bude hovoriť o týchto našich témach práve z pohľadu samosprávy a o tom, akú úlohu môže samospráva zohrávať. Nech sa páči, priestor je váš.
Are you getting too depressive? Because of all the difficult issues you were dealing with. We are quite fewer than yesterday. But still, before we start, I would like you to turn to your partner and give two questions to him. They are here on the slides. The first one is, which country would you like to visit if you could choose? Take 2 minutes to talk. Which country would you like to visit if you could choose, and why? When you have spoken to about that, you can discuss what is your favorite music band. And please hum a piece of song they had. Okay, we just carry on. You could put next one. Can I do it myself, or is it maybe better? Is it complicated?
Yeah.
Is it just push on? This is next. Okay. Just put here on. Okay, singing together. Music is an international language. So even though you have big problems, big complicated issues to discuss and to solve, you can always sing together. Do you agree with me? Yes, definitely. We are here. We are in Iceland. In a way, we could say it is an Iceland. It's a small island deep in the north. People live here around next to the coast, because of the highlands they are not easy to live in and we are so few so we need to be close to the fish. We are about 300,000 people who live there and our most optimistic plans go to maybe 430,000 at the end of this century. So all of us people like have to be busy in bed or we need to import people. So we have quite a lot of choices. We really need a lot of people now because now it is going good in Iceland. We had a big crisis, as you might know, and our prime minister came into the TV and said, "God bless Iceland," and nobody understood what it meant. What he meant. What he meant was, we have lost all our money. That was, you know, all banks closed, every bank got bankrupt, and a lot of people lost a lot of money. Some nations were quite mad to Icelanders, for example, Netherlands. So we had, in a way, to start up anew, to rethink how are we going to build our country up. Because we are a few and because we are a small country, we managed to do it quite fast, I would say. Before I talk about that more, I want to take you to Akureyri, to my municipality where I live. This is where we live, Erla, Ole, and me. This is a place in the north, and we are about 18,500 people who live there, and we have quite a nice life. And in the label of the city, they have this quote: "All accurately, all qualities of life." And what it means, it means different things to different people, but I would say close to nature, close to sea, we have mountains, we have a lot of space for everybody, we have a lot of schools, and it takes us only 2 minutes to go skiing in one of the best places in Iceland, or even more wide, to go skiing. Children can practice about 30 different kinds of sports in this little village there, which is, of course, a village comparing to your cities. We start to invite service to families to take care of children already very early, but we don't have kindergarten until they are about 2 years old. So we have day mothers. It's a day mother system we have. And that's just private sector where I, as an individual, man or a woman, I can invite people to take care of their children at my home. But they can only take five children. Each one can only have five children at home. And we have a sort of a checking system. We go for a visit and give them a sort of courses to their implementation as day mothers. But in fact, it's a private sector. But the municipality pays also part of the price because it is more expensive than a kindergarten. We have 10 elementary schools. Two of them are very small in small islands. One island is in the fjord, and one is even deep in north. And there we have only 7 children. So it's very small. But as you know, no municipality can survive if they don't have school. That's our opinion. As soon as the school closes, then you have nothing. We have 2 high schools, and they just changed it from 4 years to 3 years now. So students and teachers are quite confused at the moment. How are we going to put it all into 3 years, what we taught for in 4 years before? We have university and that's a great opportunity for our school system to have a university in the city because we have a very close work. We worked very closely together. They have a school innovation department in the university and I work a lot with them. And then we also have music school and that belongs to my job. A little bit about my job. When I'm asked, what do you do for work? And I was, what do I do for work? Okay, I decided to have this answer. I am responsible for taking care of that every child gets a happy and good school period from 6 from 2 till 15 because that belongs to my job. That is my simple answer. And my door and my office is always open for parents, for teachers, for children. I've had some teenagers in my office who are not happy about the system and I need to listen. So this is my short answer. I support teachers as much as I can and I can do it in different ways. I cannot support them in their fight now about higher salaries. That's difficult for me because I'm not the boss of the money. But I can try to support them in a professional way. And we try to make plans about... I've said to teachers, you have to remember, if you want to be a teacher, you have to be aware of that you have to be a lifelong learner. You can never stop learning. You can never stop educating. You can never stop listening to new things, looking around. What is going on in the society, in the world, in the country? So I try to support them. I have a very close work with principals. I meet them 2 or sometimes 3 times in a month to just to hear their voice, just to support them, and now we are busy with program with coaching. We are coaching them 3 and 3 together to support them. Be strong, have strong self-esteem. What do you want for your school? What is your vision? What do you need to be, because when you have a strong vision for something, it doesn't always cost money. That's what I say. It doesn't always cost money. It costs... strong vision, strong belief, and they also, they work closely together. I spoke about parents' voices. Unfortunately, when parents come to me, that is because they are not happy. They are not happy about something that the school doesn't give or doesn't support. But we try to find solutions. We have quite a lot of support. Like Hlíðarskóli, some children go there, and that's a choice. But they need to go to everything else has been tried before they go to Hlíðarskóli. And I work, of course, closely with the school's board and with the city board. I have a meeting with the city board 2 times in a month, and that helps me a lot to speak the voice of schools. And it has got to do with equipment, school equipment, even school, the houses, the buildings that we are using. So I have a very good, it's not very long way between me and the mayor. Me is just here. And if he is not listening, then I go just to his office. And a lot of collaboration with others. I work quite a lot with my colleagues around Iceland. And, for example, now these days, I am missing one meeting with them. They had a meeting yesterday in south of Iceland where we try to tell stories from our experience in our fields and support each other and so on. I want to go to my personal life a little bit because I think when you think about human rights, you always end up with you. I, with me, my heart. How do I think? Who am I? What can I do? So I want to tell you that I am a family of 7 siblings. We were 7 together at home. My father was a fisherman, and my mother, she wanted so much to study, but she was not able to because of her parents. They didn't have money. So she went 2 years to Reykjavik, and then she had to come home again. My father, he went for school for 2.5 years because his father died on sea. So they were not educated in schools, but they were highly educated from life. And they supported us unbelievably good because they wanted us to make our dreams come true. And we were born in 12 years period, so we had friends in the group all the time. We had to help each other. We needed to support each other. We had big fights also, but we had to find solutions. And there were not much money in our home, in my youth, but we never had the feeling that we were missing anything. There was a lot of music in house. My father played accordion, and we grew up with a lot of music. So many of us went into that industry, and I am educated as a music class teacher. That was my first profession. One of my brothers, he is an accordion player professional in Germany. One is drum player, one is a singer, and so on. And I'm telling you because this means that who you are and where you come from, it always gives you a thing. It always gives you idea about what you can do and what do you want, and what can you change? What are you able to change? And when you have had a very good youth, it is always in your back mind you compare your youth to everything you go when you have your own children, etc. You always have the tendency to search for the best for your children, and I think we all do, of course. When we grew up, we had partners from different countries, and even I got my husband is from Holland. I thought it was the same country, you know. Iceland, Holland is the same. Gosh, it's not. When I realized all the Calvinists' ideas about Holland and his family and that, I had been married before, and I had 2 children. That was not a good deal he made. I knew it afterwards. Being a young Netherlands guy coming from Calvinist family, having an affair and fall in love with an Icelandic divorced lady with 2 children. That was not easy. So we needed to compromise a lot, but we are still man and alive after almost 30 years. So love can survive everything. And when you get to difficult times, I just go to a very beautiful garden in Holland. Oh yes, this is why I'm with him. You know, go to the place where I met him for the first time. He is making you crazy for a period of time. You know, it's the same with him. So we just have to remember that we are human beings who search for the best in our lives. And so as you can see, this is quite an international family. And I have sometimes said to my mother, I mean, you could have a United Nations conference in the kitchen. it's so different. And my mother, the first child-in-law, the daughter-in-law, she comes from Germany, and my mother started to study German, but when the next came, she gave up, you know. And generation after generation, these are my 5 children, nice kids, all of them, very good, and they are grown up with that. Everybody has equal right as soon as you don't break the right of others. You have your own right as long as you don't break others. And of course, it can be difficult when you experience your child having difficulties in communication at school, with the teacher, or whatever. You always have to keep in mind, okay, we are humans and we need to talk, to discuss and find the best solution. This is very important view because children have fight at school. Children, they meet problems, of course. Who promised that you would, when you are born, that you will never ever have problems? Nobody has promised that. And I say now that now they are gone out in the world. This is my son here, a little bit older than here. Now he lives in Los Angeles with his very international family. He is studying being an actor. And when he moved there last August, I asked him, how is it going? You didn't have a flat or anything. It's not planned. Well, I will find some friends, he said. Are you not going to plan? Where are you going to live? I will find some friends, he said. And he came to the airport and I said, well, at least you can remember that when you are there all alone outside, you can look into heaven and say, we have the same heaven. You and we family in Iceland. And of course, he meant he has the strong belief that he would meet nice people to live with. And he did. They are living together, five together, doing very good. If I had been going, I had been planned for 1 year before, where am I going to live? Where am I going to buy my milk? It didn't worry him. And this is why I'm so optimistic when I hear young people's voices. They are not afraid. He always says, I am an earthling. I am not Icelander or Holland or Netherlander. I am earthling. And he really believes that. He is an earthling. And this is all their views. They believe it. This is my oldest son. He is jumping here on steps in front of one of the biggest high schools in Reykjavik. And this is on the gay pride day. And I put this picture on because he is fighting for minority group all the time. But he is a policeman. And so I always, when I listen to what you're discussing and talking about, then I think of my beautiful son who is a policeman, always fighting for the rights of minority groups. And the next generation, three sons, three grandchildren, sons of my daughter. They are also grown up with being friends, being helpful. But of course they have fights and they have quarreling and all kinds, but they are brought up being equal, help each other, support each other, respect each other. So it always goes through generation. When you believe in equal rights in common, and it's not difficult to live equal rights. And we are living in a democratic country, so we should all the time live it. I come back to Iceland, and I guess that most of you think about Iceland. You've heard about Northern Lights. This is the house I was grown. I'm just kidding. It's just a museum close to my little village. It's not where I lived, but there you can see these beautiful northern lights, because there are no lights close to. You might think of Eyjafjallajökull, the corruption, when you think about Iceland. I don't know how much music you know. Maybe you know this woman. She's called Björk. She's a big fighter for nature, for equality, for human rights, and things like that. And now there's a new big star. This girl, this is a group called Of Monsters and Men. She has been playing here also, but maybe they're not well known here. But she is now the Kindle, how could you say it? She carries on with the Kindle, talking about human rights. Everywhere she goes, she tries to talk about human rights all around the world. These are their shiny of monsters and men. And I just want to show you a little talk between her and the former president of Iceland. Her name is Vigdís Finnbogadóttir, and she is the first female president in the world. She is a strong role model, and I want to show it to you because it is a question of role model. There are quite many girls in Iceland who have this name, Vigdís, who took her name, because she is such a role model for us women since she became president. And she is still going around the world talking for women's rights, talking for children's rights, talking for nature, you know. And this is a small talk between them, two of them. Can you help me put it on, or can I just do it like this? Is the sound on? I hope you can hear this. Maybe the nice translators could also translate if you hear. Her name is Nanna, not Hanna. It's a spell. Yes.
We are very forward thinking, I think, when we come to equal rights.
We are, of course, one of the Nordic countries, and the Nordic countries have been considered very advanced in equal rights.
Being a woman in the arts and in music, it's great to be growing up in an environment where I feel like my potential are seen, and I'm given the same opportunities as boys are.
Women in Iceland decided to take a day off, and it became world known because they proved when they walked out from institutions and everywhere, from the homes even, that women are pillars of society as well as men. It's a very sad thing that somehow society has managed to pay men better than women. And we know that it is done by labeling the work of men differently from the work of women. And that is now what women are trying to correct,
yeah,
by working out again.
There's a lot of things that have changed, probably.
It's first and foremost the emancipation of women. There were only 2-3 women in parliament for over 70 years. But now the miracle is that half of the members of parliament are women today.
And that is remarkable. It is not considered totally shocking that a woman could be president or something like that. Is, you know,
natural.
It is so empowering.
What I've been trying to say to women is get educated, get educated, if you possibly can.
Yes, definitely. And not to be afraid of speaking up and talking about the issue and trying to be educated and having a discussion with other women, trying to figure out like how you can better your community and your society.
Because through reading they get information, and through information they learn how to handle things in their societies.
I feel very fortunate growing up here and being a woman from Iceland and having these opportunities.
There is no doubt that Iceland can be a role model for equal rights in the world.
Yes, this was our former president and this young girl. We were invited the day before yesterday to this wonderful gallery in Open Society House. And there I was talking to two young journalist students. And I liked it so much because I wanted them to hear that as long as they can speak, as long as they can write, they can fight for more equal rights. It is not a question of not daring. I mean, all these women who went out 1975 in Iceland, it was not easy, I can tell you. All companies were empty, all schools were empty, all homes were empty. It was not easy. And there were even divorces who happened after that, I can tell you. But if you don't speak, if you don't write, if you don't talk about human rights and equal rights, then nothing is going to happen. You can be sure of that. The last 21st of October, we did the same strike, 14:38. This is where our time of the day for paid work comparing to man ended. Do you understand? Yes. Yes, very well. So we just walked out. You know, we were the newest research showed that we are having such less paid for our work than man, so we were just showing, we were protesting. So we had a big meeting in the city and also in our municipality. Because if we don't talk, and it's so sad to talk about patriarchy, you know, it still exists, even in Iceland somewhere. So we need to be aware of our power, the power of talking and pointing out things which can go better. I have to tell you about small battles I did a few years ago. You can put the next one. It's nice to have somebody to help, you know. And there's a picture here. I was living, 2 years ago, I was living in a little village, in my home village, in the Westfjords of Iceland, you know, in the head here. About 1,000 people lived there. And I had been sitting in the city board. And I was there for 4 years, and then I stopped, and I wanted to go again. Because there seemed to be only one list to quote. A right politics list to vote in the little village, and I said, this is not possible. We have to be able to vote between two, at least. Don't you agree? Yes. So in 6 weeks, we were very aggressive. We made a list only of women. And they, men were, this is not good. Yeah, well, it might be a little bit old-fashioned in Iceland, but there are no women going to the municipality board if we are not doing anything. And we made a list talking about generation. Here's my daughter. I'm very proud. She came into the group also. And we managed to get 3 out of 7 in the municipality board. And what was also nice, that the other list, they changed the list and they also put it, women in their list. So now, for the first time in 70 years, the majority of the city, of the village board are women. So you can do a lot of things. It's just a question of being brave. The next one, it's just when I'm telling this because sometimes good ideas need to come from, you know, bottom up. And that was a big protest, Free the Nipple. And there was these young girls who just took off their clothes from here and they walked into the city and they went straight to the parliament. I stood in front of the parliament and they say, we want the same right as boys. They were talking about, for example, why can men go naked from above to swimming pools? Why can girls do that? They were talking about the paying the salaries for women. So they were just protesting. And they walked through the city and straight to the parliament's front door. And it was nice when I was coming now, flying to Europe now, I saw this picture. Do you know where it is? Yoko. It's Yoko Ono. Well, she was interviewed and she was holding this picture and she said, this is beautiful. Big fighter. Huh. So all these small fights, we could say fights or openings, who come just through common people, they are so important. But I wanted to just focus on what are we talking about when we are talking about human rights. I was nice to hear you this morning, Stenna, about the second, what you mentioned about just being good. Just question of being good. It's not complicated. And that means you should be good to others too. But of course it's complicated in countries where are not so far in democratic system. But human rights, they are in, they are committed between countries through United Nations on the European level, inside countries. So it should not be complicated. But still, we are breaking a lot of these contracts because we don't follow them, as has been coming here this morning. They are international, they are universal, and they are absolute. There's no discount of that. No discount. They focus on innate human dignity and the equality of human beings. It doesn't matter where you are born, if you're a boy or a girl, or if you're in Africa or in Iceland or Denmark or China or whatever. You should be born with this right. They are focusing on human dignity. And I'm not going to read all this, but just focusing on what it really means, what we have made as agreement between countries, between continents, between all around the world. So this is what we need to protect. This is what we need to work on. And even though we are at the moment a little bit scared of what is going on, we should never be afraid. Do I have 9 minutes now left? Never be afraid of carrying on, trying to change. I want to go quickly to Iceland again. This is our Icelandic general curriculum. It was performed in 2011, and there we put on 5 or 6 main basic elements that should be as a thread through all our education, through all subjects. And these are literacy, sustainability, democracy and human rights, equal rights, health and welfare and creativity. So these are our main elements who should go through all teaching in schools. And the ministry brought out 6 books for each and every element. And there is very clear what they mean by this. What do they mean by teaching lýðræði og mannréttindi? This is democracy and human rights. It's very clear what they mean. And schools are supposed to put it into every school is supposed to put it into school's policy. Every school has a school policy. And they are obligated to put these 6 elements into their school policy. And but on the other hand, when you look at next one, when you look at the list, this is you don't understand, but I just wanted to show you. There's one. Can you put again? Tick. Yep. Here, these are all subjects in schools. And here we are talking about the social subjects, religion subjects, life skills, equal rights, and ethics. And it is only 11.46% of the whole hours we are supposed to use at schools. But according to the 6 elements, they are still supposed to go through everything, through Icelandic teaching, through foreign languages, to art and vocabulary, was it vocabulary teaching? Teaching of nature, sport, through everything. This is information, this is mathematics. And here we have choose, here we can choose what we do, it's about 10%. It's not very much. So this I just wanted to show you, even though it is not so big in our timetable, we are obligated to work on this through the whole system. These are a few points who are in this book about human rights, which I showed you before. I'm not going to spend the time on that. You can just write through quickly. And I wanted to say that democracy and human rights education, it is built on this critical thinking, like has been mentioned here before. And what do you want for your society? Talking about the village of the world, what do you want? And after the crisis, we had this big meeting about 1,000 people who were chosen coincidentally to in Iceland to choose which values did we want for our nation after the crisis. And it was a great meeting, it was a great success, it was a great outcome, but now it is less than 10 years, and now most of us have forgotten that. We didn't put it really into our subject in schools, our great values for our nation. So this is one thing I would like to fight on now, because they are now starting to reorganize the educational the education for teachers, and they need to have more education in human rights and equal rights. And this is what they have complained about. Go further, I stop this. And now we have this 20th of November. It has now been chosen as the day where every school in Iceland, kindergarten and a school in Iceland, they need to teach about, need to make something special about human rights. It has been put into law. And just to tell about Akureyri, we are now starting this child-friendly cities. This is a project, I saw it from the gallery, the beautiful pictures who were there and who are here now. I guess they are related to friendly schools, children-friendly schools. But now we are focusing on, you can go further, child-friendly towns. And and Akureyri was the first one in Iceland to make this agreement. And I'm very, very proud of it. And now we have made a group of people to make plans about what we are going to do to make Akureyri a child-friendly city. What does it mean? Does it mean less work with parents? Does it mean less hours at school? Does it mean, you know, shorting the working week? We have 40 hours now. And quickly again, here just I want to tell you, we have a national radio, and they made a great success now because they planned a voting for children. And children in Iceland, they voted for parliament and they voted for our new president, because we want them to get used to being aware of that you can really change. And as soon as you start teaching about this, they are able to know what it means. Okay, and next one. It was also done in high school. They called it shadow elections. It was in most of high schools in Iceland, they made voting for parliament and voting for president. Just because we have been worried about that young people are not active enough in voting. So we need to work on that, because voting is the biggest chance you can have to change. Okay, and next one. I really have to tell only I vote is here. I vote. Okay, next one. I need to tell very short about this. This is the new entrepreneurial project in Iceland. I am proud of saying that it was my daughter-in-law, the one who is married to the policeman. They started, she and another one, in another municipality in Iceland, to change the system of how they work with domestic violence. Next one. And They changed how they work on this. They started because they found out that when something happens in home, when violence happens in homes, there was police coming and nobody was taking care of the people. It was just they were taking away, and the one who did the violence, he was put into prison or something. Now they started to focus on everybody needs help. Everybody needs help. So when a call comes to the police, it is not only the police who comes, but also a member from the civil service, childcare board, which is called, which every municipality has, and everybody is supposed to get help, even the one who is doing the violence. And this is a way of working that has now been implemented in all municipalities in Iceland, and they are now working on, and I even think she told me yesterday, Alda, my daughter-in-law, that she has a friend here in Slovakia that they have been telling about this. And this is a very important part of human rights. No child should be working or living with violence. Okay, my time is out, and I take 2 minutes quickly because I want to go to the next one just to tell you what we are focusing on now. Can you put the next one on? We have had refugees families, and we 1 year ago we got 5 families, and they have been doing good. And it's mostly because the plans we did around the whole subject, the whole project, and we are now working with talking about NGOs groups. The Red Cross in Iceland is very strong, and behind every Red Cross family, can go further? Yes. Every family has 5 families behind from the community. And every second month, we had meetings with, and the next one is just pictures. Beautiful family here with big children. See, he even came into the newspapers, this guy, he's doing good in football. So here you can see our mayor, and when there was a little discussion on Facebook about what are we doing with, are we going to take Muslim into, you know, all this discussion? What about us, you know? And he just killed it immediately, our mayor. He said, we are so happy to have them because they are bringing big resources to our society. I think I have to stop. I thought I had 1.5, but it's good. I wanted to tell you just about kindergarten school, who did a great gender project. And it appeared to be that the teachers themselves, they said it is a lack of education for ourselves. We need more education about equal rights, about human rights, so we can educate better. But they also realized that they were really doing different to girls and boys. So we need to be aware of all over the scene, what are we doing? Can I go to just the last one? This is a very small video. Very short. Sorry for, I'm, yeah? Further, next. Next one. Yeah, the last one. Still. More. I had not so much. I can see it. And here it is. Yes. This one.
Can you tell which of these children was not born free?
Oh.
Can you tell which of these children was not born free? Can you tell which of these children was not born equal? Can you tell which of these children does not deserve to be treated with dignity. We can't either. Human right number one. We are all born free and equal.
Thank you. Take care of our children.
What are human rights?
You can stop it now.
Find out.
Idem. Thank you very much. How easy is to fall in love with a country during 40 minutes? It was really, really inspirational and excellent. Ďakujem veľmi pekne. Poprosím vás dať si preklad. Please take translation. Nemáme veľa času, ale nedať vám priestor na otázky. Chcem sa ešte raz veľmi pekne poďakovať za tento inšpiratívny príspevok. Myslím si, že po týchto dňoch sme to všetci potrebovali, skončiť naozaj na pozitívnej vlne s víziou, že niečo takéto je možné. Ak sa chcete niečo spýtať, je teraz priestor, ale možno bude jednoduchšie, keď iba tak necháme v sebe doznieť to, čo sme počuli. Takže ďakujem veľmi pekne. Ešte bude priestor počas obeta možno vás zastaviť, spýtať sa na niečo. Držím palce v tom, čo robíte. Je to naozaj úžasné a výnimočné. Ďakujem.